Do-do-do-do. What? Wait a second. Trillion-dollar equation. Now let's just take a step back on that one. I've just made a video talking about exactly why things like this trillion-dollar equation fail. And then I found this Veritasium video and its enticing trillion-dollar title. And it really underlines why I made this channel, to be able to explore these things. And this is a really big problem for the average person who doesn't understand the mathematics behind this. First off, Veritasium is a great channel with a huge amount of information, but it's pretty obvious to me that there's quite a few problems with the way that Veritasium has presented this equation. What's completely missing in this video is the huge disaster that resulted from the use of this kind of method. And this isn't just me saying this. I got this story from my old physics professor, who was a bit of a Renaissance man and really understood fractals and chaos well, and from another professor from Ireland who specialized in the area of econophysics. And now I come to think of it, I've discussed exactly this kind of problem with professional traders from big banks who price options for a living. So yeah, people who know what they are talking about. The equation mentioned by Veritasium, and which is commonly used to calculate options prices on financial markets, is called the Black-Scholes-Merton equation. And it's named after its creators, Fisher Black and Myron Scholes, who published their work in 1973, and also separate work by Robert Merton. The Black-Scholes-Merton equation is a mathematical model used for pricing options contracts, which are agreements to buy some asset for a certain price at a certain time in the future. It's an important equation for sure, and most of the time it works really well, but it has a horrendous Achilles heel. This model assumes that financial markets can be represented as simple random events, which determine whether or not a stock will go up or down, and that these are effectively independent and random. Veritasium uses an incredibly nice visual representation of this by using what's called a Galton board in their video. This is a board which simulates many, many such events which determine simultaneously many decisions whether to go left or right or up and down in the case of the stock market. And it demonstrates very well how this leads to a so-called normal probability distribution, which is just the classic bell curve. It does this by dropping a whole lot of ball bearings down a chute where they bounce off pins which force them to go left or right for several layers. This is a really great moment in their video, and one of the best parts. It illustrates really well how such a process can lead to a bell curve. But the huge problem with this model is that bell curves don't actually accurately represent financial statistics.
Oh no!
And they assume that each step in the process is random and independent of the last. Now if you think about it, you ought to be able to see how wrong this is. If we have a market crash on one day, are we really going to forget about it the next? The truth is that if this happens, it would lead to further strong volatility the next day. And this is what you always find in reality. It might not be immediately obvious, but this is a huge problem for approaches like the Black-Scholes-Merton equation. This one seemingly simple behavior of financial markets can lead to markets exhibiting extreme events with much higher probability than the Black-Scholes-Merton equation assumes. Anyway, the reason that the Black-Scholes-Merton equation relies on these bell curve statistics is that it does so in order to make it solvable. This is principally why it has been so influential, because of this relative simplicity and its closed form solution, which provides a quick, simple, and admittedly powerful means for pricing options. However, the best way to model how real financial markets fluctuate is not via a random walk, but by what is called a fractal cascade model, which is a means of simulating volatility clustering. Very quickly, these work like this. Start with a value over a large time interval, and then split this in half or some other fraction, and redistribute this value on the new scale with the random weighting. After several iterations of this, we see that most of the original value gets nested within some fraction of the original interval. If these represent price movements, then we see that the size of the movements are relatively variable, with the largest movements clustered together, which is exactly what we see when we look at volatility in real financial markets. And when you look at the probabilities of obtaining extreme values, you find that this is higher for this new type of distribution. which are often called fat-tailed distributions for this reason. These distributions are particularly useful for modeling because they can account for the higher likelihood of extreme events, sometimes called black swans in financial markets, which are often underestimated by models which assume normally distributed returns. A particularly notable example of where failing to properly estimate risk occurred was the collapse of long-term capital management, or LTCM, in 1998. LTCM was a hedge fund that employed the latest mathematical models to take advantage of arbitrage opportunities on derivative markets. The founders of LTCM included the by then Nobel Prize winning Scholes and Merton. But the point is, they must have thought they couldn't lose. They had the clever, and they were very clever, mathematicians behind the Black-Scholes-Merton equation. And yet, disaster struck. To quote from Mark Rubenstein's piece in the Washington Post, where he quotes Roger Lowenstein's best-selling book about the fund's collapse. The firm's founders, a group of brainy, PhD-certified arbitragers. Many of them had been professors. Two had won the Nobel Prize. All of them were very smart, and they knew they were very smart. Initially, LTCM achieved spectacular returns. However, their models did not adequately account for extreme market conditions or low probability events. The situation came to a head during the Russian financial crisis in 1998, when Russia defaulted on its debt. This event caused a global financial shock, significantly impacting the positions LTCM held. As a result, LTCM began to suffer enormous losses. The magnitude of these positions was so large that LTCM's failure threatened to cause risk to the entire global financial system. The whole problem is that traditional financial methods rely on things like normal probability distributions, statistical independence between events, and the efficient market hypothesis. This channel's favorite mathematician, Benoit Mandelbrot, painted a very different picture of financial markets using his groundbreaking theory of fractals in the 1980s and 90s. No wonder it was considered heresy at the time. And yet, here we are today, still steadfastly clinging to outdated fantasies about financial markets. This simple point is the one really good investors get. While predicting any given movement of the market is nearly impossible, the market can swing wildly and catch fools out while creating opportunities for the wise. And that's the real trillion-dollar idea.